Liar. Everywhere. On NetRootsRadio.com. David Waldman. Kagro. In the morning. Now, here's David Waldman.
Hey, good morning, everybody. How you doing? It is Thursday, January 5th. Those things are true. 2023, that's true too. I don't know. What else can I do to mark the day? I don't know. There's no holidays or anything happening here. Hopefully the busing situation working itself out today. If you've seen this pencil case, let me know. But so far, so good. All in well. All in order. And time for another day without a Speaker of the House. It is January 5th. Today will be the third consecutive day, I guess, of trying to install a new Speaker of the House. Republicans had a series of meetings last night in which, I guess they got some of the people who are ordinarily sympathetic to the crazies, i.e. our members of the House Freedom Caucus, who have nonetheless been voting for Kevin McCarthy as Speaker, spent their time haranguing the holdouts and telling them what their stupid reasons are for switching over, and maybe they would do the same stupid thing and switch over too. Maybe they will, maybe they won't. More concessions apparently in the pipeline from McCarthy, although we'll see how it works. I mean, we'll see how wedded people are to these policy ideas for rules changes. I guess some of the holdouts have insisted, well, you know, we still want the right to be able to individually make a motion and be recognized to make a motion to vacate the chair rather than having to have five colleagues, which really at this point, I don't think you're going to see any motions made more infrequently if it's five than if it's one. Maybe a little bit, because I guess spontaneously you couldn't just get angry and make a motion to vacate the chair. But I don't know. Things took care of themselves that way for many years without that being the rule. Anyhow, and then, of course, I guess they're holding out for more committee assignments in more important committees. And we'll see whether he's interested in upsetting the apple cart and ruining his relationship with some people who have been loyal to him, McCarthy and his lieutenants, by replacing those loyal to him with those who have been, I suppose you could just term it disloyal. And we'll see how he handles that balancing act and whether it all happens today or not. Tomorrow is January 6th, the second anniversary, I guess, of our insurrection and uprising, for which hardly anybody who was actually responsible for driving it has actually been called to account. And many of them, perhaps by some count, over 100 of them, sitting in Congress today and voting on the speakership. So, you know, it's a little wacky out there. And we have more weeds we can dig in, more weeds about the weeds that we can dig in, and try and find out the philosophical basis, if there is one, for allowing members elect of the House of Representatives to determine who the third ranking or the third in line to the succession of the presidency is going to be. It's kind of a weird thing. They aren't sworn into their office. So exactly who are they? And in the case of George Santos, you have to wonder, for real, who are these people? And figure out whether they're worthy of determining who will stand behind the Vice President of the United States, third in line to the presidency, although really, honestly, if first in line to the presidency is the president, I always feel like that should really be second in line, but we always think of them as third in line for whatever reason. The line, I think, forms behind the president. There's the president, and then there's the line of people waiting to possibly become president. I don't really know why we do things that way, but we do. What can I say? There's a convention for it, and maybe that's all the reason that there needs to be for allowing people who haven't been sworn into office to make this decision. Oh, look, my app for the bus arriving is working again, so the transponder's been turned on, and I know the kiddo is already in place and ready to go, so that's good news. Just minus a pencil case, Greg. Sorry about that. Anyway, good morning.
Well,
how are you?
That's good to know.
Yeah, except his, you know, the scientific calculus.
Why did he have to promise the bus driver in order for him to come?
The bus driver wants to be able to solo motion that everybody has to get off the bus, I think.
Right. Also, the bus driver wants more input into appropriations.
That could be it, and that's why maybe he's appropriated the pencil case. There was a scientific calculator in there. I have to start all over. That's no joke.
Yeah. Well, right. I was perusing the web, looking for material, as I often do. I mean, generally, I just like to find out what's going on. And then if I happen to see it and it strikes me as material to put aside either for this show or for the pundit roundup,
the other shows,
just because
you're doing.
I want to read it later, I do so.
Okay.
And I came across this thing.
Yeah.
One of my doc friends, Rich Dusak, had this Twitter thing that I read and said, oh, this must be about Kevin McCarthy. Because it said, almost no one wakes up, looks in their own mirror, and plots the ways they're going to achieve mediocrity or worse to make your life as their leader miserable. And I clicked on it. And it wasn't about Kevin McCarthy at all, except it is, of course. It's a piece from Inc.com, I-N-C, Incorporated.com.
Oh, I see.
And it's when your company's results fall short, grab a mirror. Generally, it's the CEO's fault, is what it's trying to say. Too long didn't read.
I'm not the CEO.
If effort didn't match results, problems usually in the C-suite. Actually, in this particular case, I think we're talking about the Kevin suite. So as I understand it, and again, I had read on the internet the other day on Twitter that McCarthy had promised both his kidneys, but I felt like at this point he's actually promised 7 of his kidneys and 3 of his lungs. And the point is he's done that and he still doesn't have the votes, which I think is kind of interesting. So, you know, today's headlines, because he was doing the wheeling and dealing you were referring to, and we need to get into the weeds on that. McCarthy is on life support, but not declared brain dead, essentially, is what the headlines are saying.
Oh,
and, the most likely outcome is pundits are going to stop being honest about McCarthy because now he might win. So they're afraid of him. And so they don't feel they might have access if they're mean. So whereas yesterday they were really being quite frank and honest about why McCarthy isn't getting the speakership, like nobody trusts him and he's a weasel. Today it's more like, well, look at these votes and you just never know and we'll have to hold up and we'll have to see what happens.
Okay. I mean, he is brain dead. That's kind of a thing.
Well, he also has no spine. What makes it a crisis, of course, isn't what happens to McCarthy. Nobody cares about McCarthy. It's what's happening to the country, and that's why all these concessions that he's making to give up the speakership power in order to obtain the speakership trappings.
Yes.
And giving them up to right-wing nutjob insurrectionists is like bad for the country. So the fact that McCarthy is willing to go there and do those things, that's exactly why Hakeem Jeffries and the Democrats are not in the least bit interested in rescuing him in any way. Thankfully, there weren't that many suggestions on the internets about, well, you know, the real American thing to do would be if the Democrats simply went and rescued him.
Yes, well, I thought they would see more of that.
I mean, he's terrible, and he's not worth rescuing. And if there's anybody to rescue, it'll be whoever replaces him.
I guess so.
But, you know, the thing is to not let the 20 insurrectionists win, but that's really on the Republicans. Everything is on the Republicans. Just like, you know, this whole nonsense about, well, if Democrats had only not supported really crazy people in the primaries, then Republicans wouldn't have nominated and voted for them. Republicans nominated them. Republicans voted for them. That's why they were in the primary. They had nothing to do with Democrats. All these artificial tears about, you know, and fake anguish about Democrats supporting hardline people. When you go back and look at what actually happened, it's just about not based in fact at all. You know, you can't take out an ad and say, this guy's really horrible, he's an insurrectionist. You see, you're supporting him.
It's a funny way of doing that. Yeah, well,
but, you know, you don't support it. It's not on the Democrats. It's not up to Democrats to solve this crisis. Unfortunately, the country said, let the Republicans do it. And what we're seeing is that they can't. And the fact that they can't and the fact that they won't really is a 2-year message. However this resolves, even if McCarthy somehow bribes enough people to get the speakership, it doesn't change the fact that the Republicans are dysfunctional and they're horrible and they don't know how to govern. And they, and, you know, a significant percentage of them, 10% of them, don't want to govern.
Yeah.
And the other 90% who claim they do don't know what they're talking about and don't know how to do anything because they have the power to block all of this stuff. All they have to do is make a deal with the Democrats. And everybody explaining to you why that can't happen is misunderstanding what's going on here. Of course it can happen. I understand that it won't. But the fact that you say that it can't means you don't fully understand how bad the Republicans are and why they really should.
Yeah, that's a good point. Sure. Why it could happen if there were people willing to compromise.
Anything could happen.
But they're not.
The fact that Pennsylvania and Ohio had state legislatures where a small amount of Republicans voted with the Democrats to put in the least crazy person as, you know, as leader in their respective states tells you it can't. And, you know, it's people remind me. Same thing happened some years ago in Texas. You know, where the conservative Democrats basically banded with the Republicans to keep the even more crazy Republicans out of power.
Okay.
I mean Joe Strauss, Democrat, voted with Republicans, like, you know, almost all the time.
It's just
and,
that there's more
there was
eyes
a reason
on these
for
people.
And the reason is the insurrectionists, the Marjorie Taylor Greens of the Republican Party, are crazy. And normally what happens is Republicans make deals to keep them away from power centers. And Kevin McCarthy doesn't care about that because he's much more interested in himself. I made the point the other day that the Republican Civil War actually has three sides. And you have to understand that to understand what's going on here. You know,
okay.
You have the 90% who are conservative, center right, but basically normal people, the Rob Portmans of the world.
All right.
You have the Marjorie Taylor Greens and the absolute, they really ought to be investigated. And I don't understand how come charges haven't been brought group of Republicans. And then the third side is Kevin McCarthy. I mean, what he wants is what's good for Kevin McCarthy. And
there are more, you know, like him, but they're not on the same side.
There are, but they're not on Kevin McCarthy's side.
Because that's right. They're on whoever they are. There may be 18 sides to this war, but only three with any
recognition. There may be, you know, 222, you know, in the House.
Yeah.
But you know, the fact of the matter is that McCarthy wants what's good for McCarthy. And the question is going to be, how did the 200 or so who have been voting for him react to the fact that the 20 who are blocking everything from happening and making them look bad, how are they going to react to the 20 getting more out of McCarthy than they're comfortable with? What are they going to do? They have the power to do a whole bunch of things, including withhold their votes and tell McCarthy you can't do that because then you don't get our votes. That's the normal thing that happens. You don't even have to go as far as making deals with Democrats, although that's a possibility too. You simply say, I won't vote for you if you do this.
Yeah, who will they vote for? We don't know. Just
it doesn't
make
matter.
Up a name.
I know. The whole point is
they
to
need
hold
a name.
It up for McCarthy so that McCarthy doesn't do this.
Yes. They'll have to shout some name out.
It's,
or they could shout
not that complicated,
out,
and they make it incredibly complicated because they're torn and riven and they don't know, and they're gnashing their teeth and rending their garments. It's so stupid, you know? They completely and totally, you know, five of them have the power to get together and say, McCarthy, don't do this. If you do, you lose our vote. Period.
Yes.
Done.
Yeah. I don't know if he understands that. I don't know if they understand that.
It's, well, clearly they don't.
No,
because
not
it hasn't happened yet, but it could. So,
yeah.
So we'll see.
Okay, that will be exciting.
Now, the thing that we need to go into the weeds about are the concessions, what they mean, and also I know we've gone over this, but I think it's important to just like do it as quickly as possible, but still do it again. And we have to talk about rules, and two things about rules. One is the rules package, and the other is the rules committee.
All right.
People confuse them,
I'm confused.
The question on the table there is, what difference does a speaker make to either one? That's really what I'm asking you.
I don't know. What? Well,
so the speaker gives up what used to be called the speaker's committee, the rules committee. What does it mean? Why does the speaker have power? What does the speaker have to do with the rules committee, and why does the rules committee matter? What does it even do?
Well, okay. What what the Rules Committee does is the reason why the Speaker wants to have power over it. Of course, they are the ones who set the terms for the debate of any measure that comes to the floor. And if you can do that and, you know, and then dictate how everything will come to the floor and what amendments will be allowed, what won't be allowed, what will be attached before it gets there, how long the debate can go, who's eligible for time in the debate, all of those things, I think you can see pretty readily will have a great deal of impact on the outcome of the debate.
So a piece of legislation before it gets to the floor generally has rules set up to see how that debate's going to go. And that stems from the Rules Committee.
Right.
And the Speaker has an inordinate amount of power in terms of who they appoint to the Rules Committee.
Right. It's a very insular and small committee. It's very heavily weighted in favor of the majority. There's nothing close to equal representation for the minority on it. That's by design. And both parties will do it that way. They'll usually stack it so that it's almost, in many cases, twice as many members of the majority as there are members of the minority, so that there can be no doubt that the majority controls the outcome of the rules. And then the Speaker will generally either handpick the members, or in later days in reforms, when the steering and policy committee, or whatever each of the parties call it, that's a committee inside each of the parties that determines who gets what spots on which committees.
Well, that was going to be the next question. So really, how does that happen? How do people decide who's on what committees? If Kevin McCarthy as Speaker wants to hold over people's head, you can be on this committee, you can't be on that committee. How does he do that? What's the mechanism?
Each of the parties has what in the Democratic Party, they call it the Steering and Policy Committee, a slightly different name that I don't know if I recall off the top of my head for Republicans, just as they call theirs the Republican Conference, and we call it the caucus, but it serves largely the same function. But a committee of trusted lieutenants who help dole out those committee assignments, just as they are, generally speaking, trusted lieutenants who dole out the rules for the consideration of each of the bills. And over time, you know, that used to be that the Speaker themselves alone would dictate who would be on both of those committees, both the Steering and Policy Committee, because the Speaker was the nominal head of the party inside of the House, and the makeup of the Rules Committee, because the Speaker is the nominal head of the House of Representatives as well. So exercising two different types of power and wearing two slightly different hats, basically saying, I will make up the committee's the composition. Over the years, there have been various reforms, and they've, you know, made some more room for, I guess, what on a corporate board you might call independent members. So there's a little bit more representation, and perhaps the Speaker can't pick every single one of them.
But once they decide on a series of slots, does that then go to the House for ratification?
Once the Steering and Policy Committee decides on the slots, sometimes they make a stop and have the conference or caucus ratify that as the decision of the party as a whole. And then at that point, yes, then there's a resolution on the House floor where they throw together the list of names and assignments from the Democrats and the ones from the Republicans. And sometimes they keep them separate and pass two different resolutions, by the way. But yeah, then the House officially says, yes, the House as the House, not the parties, agrees that these will be the assignments.
Okay. So that whole mechanism for how the House functions with a tremendous amount of input from the Speaker is clearly important. And one of the things McCarthy is doing is bargaining that away, for example, by agreeing that committee assignments and assignments to the Rules Committee itself will be more open to the insurrectionists. That's one of the things that he's sort of promising.
Yes.
Right. That's different and completely distinct from the rules package.
Yeah.
That gets passed once at the beginning.
Generally,
yes. It can be modified later, but they take whatever the old rules were and they add some amendments and then they pass it. And now you have a new set of rules for the next 2 years.
Yeah, that's essentially how it works.
And that's I was trying to do my homework, so I didn't make you explain everything. Okay. But the point there is that happens at the very beginning. that's already been proposed but not voted on because there are no members, because they haven't been sworn in, because there's no speaker. And so that could be modified now, but the rules committee, the ongoing committee assignments, the action of deciding how, whether bills come to the floor and how, under what rules they come to the floor, what rules of debate and so on and so forth, an ongoing thing, is part of the power of the speaker. And that's why the speaker matters. And that's why the speaker has so much influence on what happens in the House. Did I get that right?
Yeah, pretty much. I guess a lot of it is soft power, too, I guess. You might say there are, like, for instance, the question of which bills will come to the floor is nominally the job of the majority leader, who will schedule those things. But it basically goes like, hey, do you want me to bring this thing to the floor, Mr. Speaker? I was thinking this was a good idea. And the speaker says, yeah, sure, why don't you go ahead and do that? And then he says, we're doing it. And then everyone says, the majority leader says we're doing it, everyone. You get it? So it's, you know, there's some soft power involved, too.
So part of the reason I'm asking these questions is to have a better understanding of how this stuff works. Normally, it's invisible and it doesn't matter because it's so smooth. You don't see it. You don't care.
And when,
in the midst of a who is the speaker crisis, it sort of matters. But I'll tell you where it even matters more, and this was a question that was brought up yesterday to me by John Aravosis, and I wasn't playing expert. I told him I'm not an expert on this, but here's my understanding of how this works, and you know, so I went through what I just went through with you. And then the question comes up, why are we even talking about this? What if in a West Wing kind of way, things were so terrible that 10 Republicans actually decided to vote with the Democrats, or the Republicans were so stupid that they voted present one too often. And since Hakeem Jeffries actually has more votes than Kevin McCarthy, six times in a row, Hakeem Jeffries becomes the speaker with a majority Republican House.
Yes.
How can that possibly function, given what we just described in terms of what the normal way the Rules Committee works,
it
how
would be difficult.
Stuff comes to the floor? Jeffries proposes something, the majority doesn't like it. Yeah. What happens? How is it even functional?
I imagine that the first step would be that the House rules package that would get adopted would be adopted by a majority vote by the Republicans that would strip all power from the Speaker of the House and distribute it differently. Just as we saw happen when Republican, heavily gerrymandered Republican-run states accidentally or purposefully elected Democratic governors, the first thing that the Republican legislatures did was run back to the floor and re-legislate the powers of the governor and strip them all and attach them to themselves instead. Same thing would happen. That would be the direct analog. They would just strip power from the speaker and then probably make a motion to vacate the chair.
So I now know more than I did last night.
Oh, all right, then.
A lot more. But I was right when I told Aravosis, you know what? First, it depends on the rules package, and then it depends on the rules committee.
Yeah.
As to whether or not this could work.
Right. Now, I mean,
what difference does the speaker make anyway? And I said, it makes a tremendous amount of difference.
It makes a difference when things work right. Yeah. When things are working correctly. As I mentioned, there's that soft power that sometimes gets exercised by the speaker. I mean, that works when the speaker and the majority leader, in that case, are on the same page, either because they're of the same party, or in this case, if they're not running against one another for speakership, or one's not trying to secretly plot the failure of the speaker vote so that he can step in and become speaker, and they both know that and they hate each other, then it can work. When they're at each other's throats, it might be different. Or if they're of different parties, then they just get in each other's way and screw things up. But yes, a working majority, having been shocked and disappointed at accidentally electing Hakeem Jeffries, would just say, all right, well, then the speaker just isn't that important. We're going to make him unimportant or vacate the chair and start over again. But
right. Alternatively, if they did it purposefully, what could happen is that the majority of votes in the House, which is to say the minority Democratic Party and the 10 insurrectionist Republicans in this particular case.
The good insurrectionists.
Glinda
insurrectionists.
Could vote on that rules package and pass it, or block the rules package that strips the speaker.
Mm. Yes, they could. They could fight that.
And if they did that and won, it would still be difficult because every single time you'd have a speaker with a Republican majority and you'd need those people in order to get anything done. So I'm just trying to paint the picture that, yeah, Hakeem Jeffries in theory could be elected speaker, and in practice, it would be a mess.
Yeah, it would be a weird oligarchy where the 10 Republicans would be determinative of what happened. The soft power would be theirs instead of the speaker's.
Yeah. So, you know, crazy stuff, but at least that's a framework for understanding what this is all about.
Yeah.
So why not? That's one of the major reasons why it's unlikely ever to even consider Hakeem Jeffries be speaker. It's not unreasonable to think of some compromise speaker, but that compromise speaker would undoubtedly be a Republican.
You would think.
In order to, you know, have some semblance of function. Yes, you can function in other ways, as we just laid out. But, you know, from day to day to day to day, if you want to grease the wheels, the thing that makes the most sense, the easiest thing to do, the lazy man's approach would be get a Republican you can live with, like Fred Upton, and you're not going to have these fights every 15 minutes.
Yeah, exactly. Everything that depends on the speaker's people being in place to make things happen, everything looks like the speaker is extremely powerful because even when parties have distributed power, they have distributed power to allies of the speaker. So the speaker continues to look like they're tremendously powerful, and they are because they have, you know, the ability to persuade the rest of the people who have nominally the decision-making power rests with them. They'll accede to the speaker's wishes because they're allies.
Right.
When they're
so
not,
why would
who knows?
Democrats not support McCarthy as some kind of compromise candidate? Because McCarthy goes to those places that we outlined that you simply can't go, and the Democrats will never support him.
That's true too, right? So suppose you help engineer his election by absenting yourself, and then you can't then be shocked. Oh, he's governing under the thumb of the 20 looniest Republicans in the place. I wish we hadn't done that. Too late. Hi, everybody. It's me, David. Let's change things up from the old fundraising pitch for just a minute and talk instead about how you can be a part of our show. If you've got a smartphone or any other electronic recording device, why not sit down and record a segment for us? Read us an important article and give us your take. Read one of your own original essays, or even just give us your commentary on something you'd like to share that's important to you. Then send the file to me at kgrowx@gmail.com, and I'll try and work it into the show. Short segments, a few minutes in length, are easiest to fit in. And of course, I can't always guarantee that I'll be able to play everything, but if you've ever shouted at your radio or TV about something you wish was being covered, here's your chance to change that. Make the show your own. Send your submissions to me at kagrowx@gmail.com. All right, welcome back now to the Kagro in the Morning Show here on Netroots Radio. You know, maybe I'm the leader of this show, maybe I'm not. I don't know. We'll find out. We'll see what sort of suggestions Greg has. It's in my interest to accede to his interests, really. It makes for a good show. If we fight, it's going to be bad, right? I could ultimately hang up on him, but then what would we be doing for the rest of the hour?
Well,
that's the way the power works.
I just, you know, these are the things that I actually have seen with mine own eyes being discussed over the last 24 to 48 hours. You know, and again, if you step back and look at the big picture, the Congress functions such as it does in a lot of invisible ways. And a lot of it is because there's sort of not secret, but tacit agreements to not throw sand into the gears. But if it actually were a situation where you had one vote majority, or if you had a speaker of one party and a majority leader of the other party, let's say in the House, you know, although this applies to the Senate as well, there's a lot of things that wouldn't work so smoothly. And all of a sudden, you'd be fighting and appealing and talking to the parliamentarian and voting on whether or not the chair could be overruled constantly. So it's true that he or she who has the gavel makes the rules, but the rules have to be enforced by the majority of votes. And you don't vote on everything. You don't challenge everything. You don't vote on everything. If you did, the place would grind to a standstill.
Right.
And it would look no different than what we've seen the last couple of days.
Right. That's true.
Where it's a majoritarian a situation. There are rules. Well, you haven't passed the rules package. They're not really members. The clerk, rules them all, in darkness and light and in sickness and health.
On TV.
The clerk makes the rules with the parliamentarian whispering to the clerk. You can hear the whisper. It's pretty loud. It's a pretty good mic. Telling the clerk what to say or reading from prepared. This is normally what happens. So we have seven different sheets about what you're supposed to say in these seven different circumstances that we'll hand you at the time because it's rewritten. It's pre-written because like these things come up all the time. And then it's a majoritarian situation. Whatever happens, like I would like to adjourn. Well, you can't just adjourn. You have to vote on it. And, okay, voice vote. I decide that the voice vote ayes have it. Well, I call for a yay-nay vote. Okay, fine. But then the majority decides whether or not you adjourn. This actually became important in the last 2 days.
Yeah.
Especially yesterday, because Kevin McCarthy did not want to have a vote. He wanted more time to bribe his members. And the first thing that happened, the first order of business is he was going to have one of his minions, probably Chip Roy, make a motion to adjourn. But when they counted the votes, they didn't have enough votes. They couldn't adjourn.
Yeah.
They were forced to embarrass Kevin McCarthy with three more losses. And they weren't about to adjourn. They were going to make them vote. They might have gone all night. They wanted to embarrass McCarthy. They had the votes to do it. And it's everything is like, well, if you have one more, if you have 50 plus one, 50% plus one, we're staying.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And only late in the evening after some deal making was done, did they even break for a few hours. And then when they got back, they finally adjourned for the night. So there was no vote in the evening. And then I guess we'll start again today at noon and we'll start doing votes again.
Yeah.
Or not. It depends whether or not they have enough votes to adjourn.
That's true. And all of these things, all of the hidden cooperation and tacit agreements and tendrils of soft power kind of get exposed in a situation like this. They and as you said, it's not because these things aren't happening because they have a penchant for secrecy. It's just the reality of human interaction, even if they're lizard people. You would have this difficulty if you had a speaker of one party and majority leaders. It would come down to everything. Everything would have to be verified and voted on, right down to where if the speaker says, I intend to bring the immigration bill to the floor next. And the majority leader says, well, I'm not going to. I'm the one that controls this. And maybe the speaker pulls some levers and leans heavily on the majority leader and makes it such that it's best and then really in your interest for your personal power, which I can take away some of it from you, to bring the immigration bill to the floor. Then it becomes a question of what is the immigration bill? Because the Rules Committee can change the contents of it after it's been written. And the majority leader says, hey, man, I brought you the bill with that number and that title. The contents are what I wanted to bring, but I fulfilled my end of the bargain. You said I had to bring this bill. I did. It looks different. But now it's you have to verify everything along the way. This isn't the version I brought. And it gets down to the level of just like at insurrection time. You asked me to bring you the electoral votes. Here they are. They say Donald Trump won. These aren't the electoral votes. These are fakes. Who's to say? Let's vote on it. If enough people say the fakes are the real ones, then they're the real ones. Wait a minute. We can't run the government like this. Yeah, that's right. It's the same as it was on January 4th. We can't run the government because we can't trust one another to agree on what are the terms. So,
right. And so if nobody can trust McCarthy, because he really doesn't have seven kidneys to give up and three lungs, even though he promised it, which gives you an idea of how people don't trust him, then the fact that he's not speaker has a lot to do with the fact that people don't trust him, and people in his own party, some of them at least, clearly hate him.
Yeah, I think they kind of do, which is hard to imagine. He's just so wishy-washy. Don't know what to hate. Yeah, but I guess he's a real thorn in their side, I guess. Never, you know, always getting in the way of what they think they want, only because what they want is insane or impossible sometimes. But
yeah, what they want in an H.L. Mencken way.
Yeah, I guess that's true, right? Well, I want to wake Cthulhu. Well, I don't. Well, you're a pain in my ass then. Well, all right.
Democracy is the idea that, you know, you ought to really get what you're asking for, good and hard. So this is something that I picked up. I don't even know what the source is. It looks like it's like a Politico type thing. Yeah. What it says is major changes to the appropriations process as part of Kevin McCarthy's bargaining. Fears of another $1 trillion-plus omnibus spending bill have been a major driver of the conservative backlash to McCarthy. The brewing deal includes a promise for standalone votes on each of the 12 yearly appropriations bills, which would be considered under what's known as an open rule, allowing floor amendments to be offered by any lawmaker. Conservatives also want a concession to carve out any earmarks included in the package separately, but it's unclear if they'd be voted on as one package or voted separately.
Yeah. Oh, there's another little weird difference. I mean, this is a substantive ask, a dumb ask, but a substantive one. And is it fulfilled if you say, well, all right, we're going to have a standalone vote on all these things, but then in the end, we'll throw them all together in one package and vote on it all at once? But no, you said standalone. Well, we had both. It's a hybrid. No, I want only this. Why? Because I don't know. I promised that, and I don't really understand what I'm doing. And now it looks like I didn't fulfill my promise. All right.
Because there's 12 earmarks, and I only agree with 10.
Yeah, maybe that.
And basically, what they're trying to say is, if you don't give me absolutely everything I want, you're getting nothing from me.
Yeah.
And I'm not just saying this at the time that you're going to be speaker, using this as ammunition and holding out so that I get what I want. I'm telling you, from now on, you were to give me absolutely everything that I want, always, on every single item. I mean, that's basically what this is saying. And, you know, you can't function like that. You have to compromise at some point to get anything passed in the House. I know that. I'm not even a House member.
Yep, yep. It's not easy.
No. It's not. It's not easy understanding it, but once you understand it and then you go about trying to do it, it's even harder. May I point out, Nancy Pelosi was very good at her job.
Yes, now would be an appropriate time to do that, I think.
This all was invisible. You never saw this stuff. It was never an issue for the public. It was always an issue for her and every single one of the House members. But it was never an issue for the public. She just got it done.
Yeah.
Well, for years.
And many speakers before her have done the same. And
She did it with a 4-vote majority.
Mm-hmm.
And she did it in bills and dancing backwards.
I mean, this is also it's at the root of a lot of, not all of them, not all of the insurrectionist 20 holdouts have the same reasons. Maybe not even two have the same reasons. But those who are saying, well, we want more openness in the process and there needs to be an end to the secret deals that make this place run. A lot of those so-called secret deals are just the same, you know, tacit agreements between humans to get things done. There's a process for bringing things to the floor. Well, I want to be able to intervene at some point in it and say, hey, I'm Chip Roy and I want this amendment. Well, you know, 200 other people don't. Sorry, Chip. Well, this is a blow against openness and democracy. No, it isn't. It's 200 against one. Democracy triumphs. Yes, but if we don't do it out in the open, then I can accuse you of making secret backroom deals. And that's the sort of thing that sparks people to say, well, we're against that. Well, there was no secret backroom deal. They met in the same rooms they usually meet in, and it was 200 to one.
Right. But, so, you know, again, and people have noted this online. I'm not the first one to say this.
No, good. Then I can.
But, you know, it's the difference between a failure to govern and a refusal to govern. Those are two different things.
Yes.
And we have a bunch of people on the Republican side who basically refuse to govern. They will not allow stuff that normally would simply allow things to function.
Mm-hmm.
So, just out of principle. Yeah, you say we have no principles, but my principle is I want nothing to succeed.
Well, you have me there on a technicality. That is a principle. So I'm wrong. Therefore, I'm a liar, and I need to be impeached and possibly prosecuted.
I'll impeach myself, right? So I'll have an election for the party of one that I belong to, and we'll see who wins. Mm-hmm. Caitlin Collins sums up how things stand this morning. GOP Representative Warren Davidson tells me the 20 hardliners against McCarthy will be meeting at 8 a.m., so they've already started. While he believes some of the concessions made overnight have made a difference, the tough part is I think the number that will never vote for Kevin McCarthy is more than four.
Mm-hmm.
If that's true, that means he'll never be speaker, I should point out.
It's hard to get to less than four from 20.
Yeah. So I thought, and again, to give you an idea of what's going on, here's one of the more staid news organizations, the Associated Press.
Yes.
GOP's McCarthy pressured to figure out speaker race.
How can they pressure the speaker? Well, he's not the speaker.
I sent you one of the many memes going around. Mm. This is very funny. As you may know, if you try to click on something and they want to verify that you're a human, you'll often get a picture like a grid with nine things on it. And you have to pick out the telephone poles. You have to pick out the ones that have tractors, you know, pick out the ones that have traffic lights. That's one of my more common favorites ones we see. And this one has a picture of six branded stereo speakers and three pictures of McCarthy. And the idea is to pick out the speakers.
Right. Not this one.
And it's not the two with McCarthy on it, that's for sure. It's all the other ones.
Yeah, all right.
So that's where things stand this morning.
I saw that one. And I think no one can figure out who made that one. Step forward.
That's brilliant. McCarthy is under growing pressure from restless Republicans and Democrats to find the votes he needs or step aside. That's the thing.
Hmm.
There should be pushback from the not 20 to, look, if you can't get this done and this is the only way you can get there, it's better you step down.
The only person who was willing to say that explicitly on the House floor, they got Lauren Boebert to do that dirty work. It's not that you say it in private or you make comments to the press, but it's sort of in the category of not done to go on the House floor and in nominating the rival, in this case, Byron Donalds, to say, you need to step down. That's like, now, Lauren, you better hope he doesn't make it.
She said, you need to step down, and Mr. Trump, you need to shut up.
Yes, that's true, too. She better hope that it comes out the way she wants. All right, so, you know, she put her neck on the chopping block there, which is fine, by the way.
If no one else
takes a swing, I will.
Buck came very close and said, this isn't working, and we really need to think through what we're doing here.
Yes, that's the genteel way of doing it. That's good. That's, you know,
but it wasn't a House speech. It was a response to a reporter's question.
I don't think Lauren she doesn't understand the dynamics.
Very smart.
No, she's not. She thought she was being bold. And I mean, I'll tell you what happened was that if you didn't see it, she's nominating Byron Donalds. She used that as the crescendo line, the closing line of her speech, nominating someone else. Her closing line is a pot shot. A direct attack at another candidate. So her nominating speech, how do the nominating speeches usually end? Thunderous applause, or not necessarily thunderous, polite applause, whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
Her speech ended in, boo.
Yeah, she got booed.
Yeah, Byron Donalds.
No, they were saying boog.
Yeah, Byron Donalds.
Ballmer.
But, you know, I mean, Byron Donald was, I think, if they had a shot of him, that would have been something. He probably was like head and hands like, oh, why did I agree to do this? Now my name is associated with this idiot getting booed on the floor nominating me.
Somebody asked him if he was worried about that sort of thing. And he looked at him and said, I'm like 6'7 and 270. I don't think so.
I guess that'll provide some protection. He should hang out with John Fetterman a little bit.
I think so. Yeah. Anyway, another state organization in terms of how they're handling it. This is the New York Times this morning. Nobody is in charge. A ragged GOP stumbles through the wilderness with no unified agenda, no clear leadership. Republicans face the prospect that the anti-establishment fervor that's powered the party in recent years could now devour it. So for those of you who have never read A Tale of Two Cities and don't know who Madame Defarge is, it's time to go Google it up and learn a little bit about what happens to revolutions. Or you could just ask Newt Gingrich.
Yeah. He's still on TV occasionally.
He's actually saying sensible things now.
Oh.
Like shaking his head saying, this isn't going to end well.
Oh, well,
how would you? Oh, yeah. I guess I do know how you would know.
Well, yeah, you know, he's guilty of the same, but anyway, that's his thing. He goes back and forth. When it comes election time, he gets crazy again.
Yeah. Never well, look, he's not a good person, but I'm just saying in this particular case, he knows what he's talking about.
I guess that's true. Keeps him on TV. All right.
Well, they kicked me out because I couldn't control the thing I unleashed.
Yeah.
Oh, really? That's what happened. Oh, yeah. Well, does that mean we should listen to anything else you say about any other topic? No, but on this, yeah.
Yeah, I guess maybe that's true. I know what it is to have to be devoured by my own spawn.
Yeah. Anyway, here's one. This is S.E. Cup writing in the Daily News. Kevin McCarthy got the GOP conference he deserves.
Okay.
I like that. Poor Kevin. My Kevin, poor Kevin, oh, Kevin, the Bakersfield, California native who, by all accounts, came to Washington 16 years ago with the sole intent of becoming speaker, one day faced an embarrassing defeat on Tuesday when he failed three times to win the nomination by his own party. And then, of course, the next day he failed four more times, because you have to now appreciate the fact that in normal times, where you look to say in the Senate whether or not you can get cloture on something as the test vote.
Yes.
But these days, whether or not you can adjourn is the test vote.
Yes, that's right.
If you can't adjourn, you don't have the votes.
Yeah, that's right. That's
what happened. So he failed four times.
That's the House version
of
the
test
vote.
Is what I'm saying. He failed four times yesterday. First, he couldn't adjourn, and then he failed on his three votes. So that's what they're saying. And the other, she says there's no mystery as to how Kevin McCarthy, the former House Minority Leader and House Majority Leader for the Republicans, got here. He's an unprincipled sellout and made all the wrong bargains with all the wrong people. And in the end, it might not even have been worth it.
Yeah.
Pretty straightforward there.
Right. I guess so. That pretty much explains it. Yeah,
What else are you going to say? I mean, even Chuck Todd was saying that, you know, I don't know, this Kevin McCarthy thing, he's made all the wrong choices and, you know, he has no backbone and he's unprincipled and maybe that's why he's not going to win.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I mean, that I think is understandable.
Everybody recognizes it. It's so weird. David Jolly made an interesting point, which hadn't occurred to me, and that is he said, you know, the other thing about McCarthy, and he was arguing with Brendan Buck, and there is a story there. Brendan Buck worked for Boehner and he worked for Paul Ryan. And he is in that sense, has credentials, expert qualified to talk about how these speaker battles go. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, he is so embedded with the Republican establishment, he cannot conceive of what happens when they lose.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for example, he said, you can't even discuss making deals with the Democrats. You just don't do that. It'll never happen. It can happen. It would be horrible to me if it happened. I can't foresee it happening.
Okay.
That doesn't mean it can't happen. It just means he can't see it. It's like beyond what his head would explode.
Yeah.
And he basically told us that on the air. But he was having a debate with David Jolly, and Jolly said, you know, the interesting thing about Kevin McCarthy is that he's never been a backbencher. He came in, had a quick leadership ride.
It must have been.
Never toiled on some obscure subcommittee, you know, and to know what that's like and what folks there think and what they want and what they need to function. He doesn't know any of that.
That's interesting.
And I thought that was interesting. Brendan Buck said, yeah, well, that's not quite fair because he's a real study of districts. He learned everybody's district. He did it so he can get power. But he would go in and talk to you and know more about your district than you did because, you know, he wanted to know what you needed so that you would like him and then give him a vote and this, that, and everything else. So he may not know how the House works, but he knows a lot about politics.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's...
And both can be true at the same time.
There's a lot of parallels in that to that story we've been reading about Elise Stefanik. I mean, they came from different places, but they certainly were motivated by similar things. But yeah, of course, the same thing was very frequently
said by... Well,
she's
also an unprincipled sellout who made all the wrong bargains with all the wrong people.
That's true. Now, people did say that the same practices, even if not necessarily being a total sellout with no principles whatsoever, although some people say this about him too, but I think back to the stories about Bill Clinton, like writing down index cards of everybody he ever met so that he could, you know, at 16, so I'm going to be president at some point. I need to have notes about everyone I meet so I can remind them that we met so that they'll vote for me for president. It's a weird thing. But, you know, on the other hand, if you have a policy you'd like to pass, well, then maybe it's a great idea. But if you don't have anything in particular you want to do, you just like this office, it might not work out so well.
Right. So she writes, in tolerating and in fact courting, and again, this is all interesting to me because she's basically a conservative. In tolerating and, in fact, courting new Republican House candidates who were less interested in governing than they were sucking up to Trump and becoming famous, he got Republican House members who aren't at all interested in governing. We just went over how and why that's true. And who were willing to blow up their own majority in the process. As McCarthy's former mentor, Representative Bill Thomas, has recently said, Kevin basically is whatever you want him to be. He lies. He changed the lies if necessary. How can anybody trust him?
Okay. Yeah.
If that's what your former mentor thinks about you, it's probably true.
Yeah. What a strange... I'm looking now, by the way, at his Wikipedia
And those are the
entry.
Good things that people say about Kevin.
That's true. I mean, if he had had a vision in mind and had been an effective leader, what an effective leader he would be. It's really true. I was astonished at the idea that he's never spent any time as a backbencher. And I think I thought, how could that even be? And okay, it's technically not true because in his first term, he didn't hold a leadership office. But literally, by his second term, he holds a leadership office. And the same story in his service in the California state legislature as well. He serves one term, and then, boom, he's in leadership. How did he do it? I mean, you'd think he was a stellar politician, but he's just a stellar guy at getting in the door. And they're like, all right, I guess we'll let him in. He's inoffensive enough. Oh, crap, he's our leader. And only at this point is finally the only clear-headed people about this are the 20 crazy insurrectionists who have totally different reasons for opposing him. But I guess an alien race observing this could say, these 20 have discovered that, you know, this guy is an empty suit. Yeah, no, they want to be the empty suits.
Right. So I'm going to give you just a picture. I gave you one of the pictures, but I want to do
pictures.
both days. Yesterday's Daily News, the New York tabloids are great at like putting their finger on the pulse of like what's really going on and what do people think. The Daily News doesn't even have McCarthy as the main story, but they do have a headline at the top. McCarthy deep 60 loses a six.
Oh, I see. Yeah, six.
Sixth vote there. And the New York Post yesterday had a picture of Lauren Boebert. The New York Post is the Rupert Murdoch tabloid. I had a picture of Lauren Boebert and Matt Gaetz giving a press conference, it looks like. Small group of Republican saboteurs blocks McCarthy from taking power, and their big headline over the picture of Boebert and Gaetz is, grow up.
Huh.
That was yesterday.
All right.
And then today, since it didn't go well again, they decided, like the Daily News, they weren't going to make it like the super duper main story. So they have a picture, of course, of the migrant crisis. And what they say is, while pointless speaker fight drags on, Biden's border is still wide open. Yeah, hey, D.C., focus on the real crisis.
All right. Well, that's the distraction.
So obviously it's not going well for them. They want McCarthy, and it's not happening.
Okay. Well, they're powerless to do anything about it. They should just go to Bat Boy again.
Yeah, I suppose. But again, you know, it just gives you an idea in that world of how badly things are going. This is not really how they scripted it all out. And so they're sort of doing this on the fly at this particular point in time. And then finally, the other concession.
Oh, yeah, there's more?
Kevin McCarthy made, which sort of isn't a concession because it sort of isn't direct and you're sort of even not supposed to know about it, is that his super PAC has agreed with the Club for Growth super PAC. They can't coordinate among super PACs can't coordinate with candidates, but super PACs can coordinate to each other.
I guess that's true.
They're really not going to get so heavily involved in trying to choose who the nominees are in the Republican nominating process. And the insiders think this is a, you know, some of them think this is a huge, super big deal. And others think this is really stupid. It doesn't matter all that much. It's like vacating the chair. It gets really sexy headlines and a lot of discussion. But as you pointed out at the very beginning of this entire show, it doesn't really make that much difference in the long run. It doesn't come up that often, and it's not going to come up that often no matter what they do.
Yeah. But so super PACs agree not to do what?
Yeah, they're not going to put their finger on the scale to try to block super duper conservative people from running. They don't want, the conservatives don't want the Mitch McConnells blocking the Todd Akins from being the candidate.
Oh, so for seats in the legislature, not, this isn't a presidential race?
No, this isn't a presidential race. They're talking about primaries.
So, okay. So, building a caucus for yourself with Club for Growth and Kevin McCarthy's Super PAC say they won't put their thumb on the scale in Republican primaries for Congress.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that's a lie. Good concession.
It's a lie. Right.
Excellent concession.
Because nobody can force them to do anything. Yeah.
Good. All right. That's a great lie. That's a very savvy lie.
But it was treated as like, oh, this is a super huge big deal. We have breaking news in evening punch bowl that everybody has to read because this is like a scoop and huge super duper stuff.
Well, to the insurrectionists,
whatever.
Yeah. To the insurrectionists, they probably like, yeah, we finally, extracted a promise to have this happen. Maybe they know, maybe they don't, that it's kind of unenforceable and the definitions of the terms will change.
It's a momentum.
But we demanded this and we got it. So they probably ran out and issued a press release and made a big statement and punch bowls. Information has been handed to me on somebody's letterhead. Scoop, exclusive.
Right. And some of the political operatives I know on the Democratic side shrugged their shoulders and said, it's not the big deal that they're making it out to be.
Okay. Yeah, fine. So they're playing some. That's all right. They dressed up a lie as a big concession. Everybody, I think both parties to that agreement understood.
It's a highly inside baseball thing. But at the same time, I feel like sometimes part of our role here is to explain some of the inside baseball stuff in terms of why they're even talking about it.
Sure. Why not? I don't know. We're talking about it because they're talking about it, and they're talking about it because somebody else talked to them about it. Fair enough. Okay. Want to try again next week?
Sure.
We'll make you speak.
Pick a day.
All right. Welcome back now to the Kagro in the Morning Show here on Netroots Radio. Greg may still be listening, so it's time to update you on this. I took a look at Kevin McCarthy's Wikipedia entry, and I have that handy box that runs down the gutter of the right-hand side where they put the member and when they were first elected and all the various offices that they've held. And it really is remarkable for such a guileless and unprincipled person to have achieved the record that he has. But I guess it's explainable only in... Well, look, he's willing to do whatever it takes, and he'll just mirror, he'll give you back the feedback you want. He's, personable, and he'll say the things that he thinks you want to hear him say in order for you to trust and like him and be willing to put him in leadership. And he did understand this dynamic, which is, you can't walk in and say, bam, I want to be Speaker of the House. It doesn't work that way. To the extent that he's got any understanding of backbencher mentality, it is that he's got eyes on the speakership, but he realizes he's going to have to start by putting in, 2, 4, 6 years as chief deputy whip, and then, deputy whip, a deputy whip, and then chief deputy whip, and then the whip, and then then minority leader, and then majority leader, and then so... He's put in the time that way, which is analogous to how a backbencher, sits at the end of the dais at the lowest ranking position on this crap committee, and then you work your way up, and then you get a subcommittee chairmanship, and then you maybe even switch committees to something more powerful, and you work your way up to a subcommittee chairmanship there, and then you're third ranking on the committee after a while, and then maybe you're in line for a chairmanship, or you climb the leadership ladder. It takes a while. But it is kind of interesting that just, I guess, if you just show up with a plan, it's interesting for starters to show up and say, I want to be speaker. And then someone might ask you why, or you internally have that dialogue. Well, why do you want to be speaker? I don't know. I just do. I mean, it's a cool office. Everyone will say I'm the coolest guy in Congress. I'm the top guy. I have power. What do you want to do with the power? I don't know. You know, it's not even so. Sometimes people point to it and say, well, it's a desire for power. And sometimes, I guess, if you have no principle and no vision whatsoever, it might not necessarily be power. It's just validation. Like, I don't know, that's the biggest, most awesome job they've got. So I want to go for it. And I want a lot of participation trophies on my way up. And therefore, I'm good enough. I'm smart enough. And doggone it, people like me. And that guy actually made it to Congress. But looking at his record, it is remarkable. So going all the way back to at least as far back in politics as they're willing to put in your Wikipedia bio, he is a member of the California State Assembly beginning in 2002. That's not a super long career, by the way. So what year is it again? 2023. So 21 years in politics. I mean, some people are 21 years in the House of Representatives before they become speaker. But anyway, you know, it's not a short time. But okay, so how old is he anyway? He's 57 now, 1965. He's born in 65. So what? 75, 85, 95, 2005. So before he's 40, you know, it's not unusual. He's in no great hurry. Where was it? 2005 would have been 40 years old. So minus 2 or 3 years there. He assumes office somehow in December 2nd, 2002. Maybe he was in a special election or something like that, perhaps. So he's 37 or so, I guess, by the time he gets to the state legislature. But he's elected and assumes office December 2nd, 2002. And by January 5th, 2004, so let's see, he's at the end of 2002. So he spends 2003 on the backbench, but by January of 2004, which I presume is his second term in office, he is Minority Leader of the California State Assembly. Now, that's not a super powerful position or anything, but it's the highest ranking position of Republicans in the Assembly. He just joined them. He didn't even, I guess, serve a full term prior to that. And then boom. And I mean, again, there it's sort of like, well, who wants to be the Minority Leader of the California State Assembly? Talk about, you know, no job, nothing to do. Well, you know, I'm famous. I get an office. I'm in the top job. I can use it as a springboard to other things. Nobody else wants to do it because it's thankless. And the Republicans in the California state legislature, you know, are just, you know, they just run roughshod over us all the time. We don't win any votes. It's all about messaging and saying, you know, well, we're for freedom, so we're going to lose a lot. Fine. And so he does that. And he does that for all of 2 years before he rides that into Congress. So December 2002, he arrives in the California State Assembly. January 2004, he assumes the minority leadership of the California State Assembly. He holds on there until April of 2006. So just over 2 years, he's in that position. But then, I guess, resigns to run for Congress. I don't know whether he resigns. He probably didn't resign his assembly seat, but maybe he steps aside as minority leader. And then by January 2007, he is sworn in as a member of Congress. So January 2007. By January 2009, the very next term in office, he is House Republican Chief Deputy Whip. Maybe he spent time, he may have volunteered. At that level, you can say, all right, you know, I'm here, I'm a freshman, I will be a deputy whip, or I'll be, sometimes they elect, you know, they try to give everybody a little position, like a participation trophy, really, truly. Like you may say, he might have been the Republican freshman class whip or something for the Republican freshman class of 2007. Who knows? I don't know how many people were even in it. Some people don't even know that there are such things. If you have some legislative experience prior to that, then you can offer yourself up. Everybody else kind of gets out of the way. So now you've been that. And then, you know, you make impressions on people, I guess, somehow. So, but there he is. In his second term, he is Republican Chief Deputy Whip. Not deputy, Chief Deputy. Hanging out there along with John Boehner and Eric Cantor. Now he's in the Young Guns, even though he's not all that young. But whatever. First term, backbench. Second term, Chief Deputy Whip. Third term, House Majority Whip. So he's Chief Deputy, and then boom, jumps right into it. Because Republicans take control of the House, I guess. And everybody has to, that creates a vacancy. Who was ahead of him in leadership? Boehner, Cantor, and I don't know who else was the whip at that point for the Republicans. But at that point, they take over, and Boehner gets to step into the Speaker's office, which means Cantor gets to move up to the Majority Leader office, which means there's an opening at the whip level, and he jumps in. So there he is. 2011 to 2014, he's the House Majority Whip, but then they lose control of the House, and Boehner's gone, Ryan's gone, Cantor has left, so he's like the next in line. They boost him up. He's House Majority Leader. Who wants to take this job now that we've lost control of the House? Nobody. And then, you know, from there, he's House Majority Leader. I guess that's it, really. And he's just House Majority Leader until 2019. Then he becomes Minority Leader, but they, you know, term that something different and call it Leader of the House Republican Conference. But no, House Minority Leader until he becomes Speaker. But so that's really kind of amazing. He's got 2 years in state office, not in leadership. 2 years in federal office, not in leadership, but 21 years in elected politics, all spent, you know, climbing the ladder. But to what end? I don't know. Which I guess explains how you can get to this point and still be just, you know, a non-factor. And people very easily say, nah, I'm going to stand in the way of his election. Yeah, he doesn't mean anything to me. He hasn't done anything. And all the while, studying his, you know, districts and who represents what, to play the inside baseball, and missing the governance part of it. Like I keep bringing up when the House leadership got together to talk about having just met the then Prime Minister of Ukraine, coming to them to talk about Russia is invading us and they have this whole crazy plan to you know, overturn democracies worldwide, and we really have got to do something about it. You could be next. And his reaction to it. Everybody else is talking about the maniacal plan and how they have to stop it. And he's like, "I think Putin pays Trump. I didn't even pay attention to what you were talking about." But this is about Ukraine, actually. You know, we were talking about Ukraine, and you're now talking about Russia. But Russia was doing the invading, yes. So, and not totally off topic. But everybody says, "What the hell are you even?" All right, and then everybody has to be sworn to secrecy. Great play, Kevin. That was awesome. Maybe you'd like to be Speaker now. All right. Well, anyway, I found that rather remarkable, to say the least. Let's see. Other things that I could share with you that are of some importance. So let's see. Oh, I put some of these things away, but I don't know if I forgot. I think when I originally did it that we might not lead. It might not – the links in – pocket might not lead directly to the Mastodon toot I'm thinking of. But in this case, this one does. This is sort of a weird, crazy kind of situation here. Arch Pundit, let us know that, who did this? This is Matt Fuller on Twitter saying that, heard on the House floor, essentially, as people are beginning to have fun with this thing, even though this repeated voting is quite boring. They're entertaining themselves. And sometimes you can't quite hear, there's sometimes laughter or cheering will result on, you can hear over the microphones on C-SPAN, but you can't make out what was said. Apparently, just for the record, here for KITM listeners, and Greg would appreciate this one. What's the story here? Somebody is voting, and I guess if I go over to the Twitter account, I can find it. Ah, yes. So Arthur Delaney reporting and Matt Fuller confirming who it was, that Representative Jared Huffman, in casting his vote for Hakeem Jeffries in one of the 18,000 times that they had to do this in the last couple of days, apparently entertaining himself by calling out Hakeem Jeffries, like Leroy Jenkins style, apparently. So a good throwback to early days internet memes, and something we enjoy a great deal here on the show as well, as a Leroy Jenkins style call out for Hakeem Jeffries. Why not? Make your own entertainment wherever you can find it. All right, let's see. Other things that I definitely, totally wanted to share. All right, let's see. We still have, there's still more garbage about Elise Stefanik that we really should get through. And maybe we should go all the way back to that one, because you never know when she might turn up as the nominated alternative to Kevin McCarthy, and they may let her experiment with that before Steve Scalise takes a shot at it. I don't know what the plan is, but let's see. Where did we leave off when we were reading with her? There needs to be a way in Pocket to mark these things. We definitely started reading the "She has become a star" thing from Donald Trump, saying she had become a star because she was willing to do the things he wanted done. Right, that she had became a star and a breakout star in the impeachment hearings. And then she began establishing websites to raise money at fightshift.com, et cetera, et cetera. And that she was getting bookings on Fox News thanks to her antics, that she marveled to her friends at the flood of money that was coming in by going ultra MAGA, right? Did we get to the next section? Let's see. Oh, yeah, right. Then her reversal on Fauci and how she used to tweet, America hearts Dr. Fauci, and now writes, fire Fauci, save Christmas, things like that. All right. Let's see. Scanning down a little further. We'll see if I can't figure this one out. And let's see. After Trump's election defeat, did we read this part? He fomented a deluge of lies and conspiracy theories about cheating and voter fraud. Ms. Stefanik quickly fell in line. Mr. Trump had made his election lies a litmus test for fellow Republicans, and Stefanik was unwilling to fail it. Ryan, I think I do recall reading something about that. Oh, right. And that she had sort of bootstrapped her lies to her constituents about her supposed beliefs about the election having been stolen, and then whipping them into a frenzy about it, then points to the frenzy and says, look, they're just, you know, rightly concerned about election integrity. And what could I do? I have to promote her. And then she gets the angry note from her friend at Harvard, or several of her friends at Harvard. And then at some point, right, a few days later, the dean of the Harvard Kennedy School, which oversees the Institute of Politics, asks Stefanik, at the invitation of a letter writing campaign from others, they kick her off the board. So then she turns to, oh, well, that's a badge of honor to be kicked off the board by those liberal elites. Then, her original position on what to do with Liz Cheney when people were getting irritated with her inside of the Republican conference. A few weeks after the insurrection, House Republicans met to consider removing Liz Cheney, right? Then the party's highest ranking woman in Congress from her job as conference chair. In the two previous leadership contests, Stefanik herself had stood before colleagues to nominate Cheney, once calling her a huge asset in the role, but Cheney had now voted for Trump's second impeachment, infuriating not only Trump, but a broad range of Republican lawmakers who complained that she had made their party look divided. Oh no, that's a huge sin, right? Making your party look divided. We have to have her out. She's to be kicked out, said probably most, if not all, of the 20 insurrectionists now making their party look divided in the speaker vote. So that's worth noting. Days after the vote, Politico reported that Ms. Stefanik had privately signaled her interest in replacing Cheney. That February, Cheney's colleagues voted to keep her in the job, but as Ms. Cheney continued to speak out against Mr. Trump, the woman who had remade her principles to fit her ambition set out to depose the one risking career suicide in service of hers. Though Ms. Stefanik had a far more liberal voting record than the woman she wanted to replace, she worked both sides, making clear that she would neither embarrass Republicans who had cowered before Trump's election lies, nor anger supporters who insisted on believing them. Her argument, as one Republican member recalled, is, "I'm a woman, I'm young, I'm reasonable, I like Liz, but we need to quit focusing on January 6th. Huh. Mr. Trump's ringing endorsement that May sealed the deal. Cheney was out, Stefanik was in. It became harder then for her to reconcile the identity she said she hadn't abandoned with the power she had finally grasped. This is a little bit of a McCarthy thing, I guess. She dropped her support for the Equality Act, a bipartisan bill aimed at extending housing and employment anti-discrimination rules to gay, lesbian, and transgender people, pulled her name from the Republican-backed gay rights bill known as the Fairness for All Act, saying she now had serious concerns about how this bill would impact society, and that even though, parenthetically, it is noted here, she recently voted in favor of bipartisan bill mandating federal recognition for same-sex marriages. So I guess she's still okay on that one. Her voting score with Heritage Action went from squishy 24 in 2018 to a stalwart 86. I think we got through all of that. She has repeatedly voted against spending bills championed by, oh yes, I remember, I think this was the one we got right over the music. Voted against spending bills championed by Biden and the Democrats, then taking the credit for the money and that those same bills delivered back home. The very frequent say vote no and take the dough game. Last March, her press office alerted upstate reporters that Stefanik had secured $205,000 for job training in Warren County, though a news release from her Washington office, right? Again, upstate, her in-district press secretaries told local papers that Stefanik secured $205,000 for job training and put it in the bill. The news release from the Washington office was that she couldn't support Speaker Pelosi's bill, which was drafted in the dead of night. And I didn't get a chance to say the other day when we were reading that, you know, part of that drafting was, according to her upstate press release, her putting in $205,000 for job training in Warren County. You don't think that sounds like it's as dead of night as anything else? But just simply tell two stories. If you can't reconcile them, then tell their voters, your constituents, one story, and tell the Washington press a totally different story. It's okay in this world. The further Ms. Stefanik traveled into Mr. Trump's world, the deeper she seemed to dig in. She hadn't changed. Her former friends had. They were out of touch. It's the children who are out of touch, right? The children who are wrong, I guess. They were out of touch, driven mad by hatred of Mr. Trump. That spring, Representative Seth Moulton of Massachusetts, a fellow Harvard graduate and her Democratic colleague on the Armed Services Committee, again, another Harvard grad from the Institute of Politics, and it's just weird that, Seth Moulton, too, is, like, weirdly ambitious and no one else has any real understanding of why he would consider himself a candidate for anything, like speaker or president, but he just does. That's just what people who go to Harvard think about themselves. Oh, he approached her on the House floor. Both elected in 2014, they often had lunch together at the Capitol and had mutual friends outside Washington. Speaking carefully, he told her that people were worried about the course she had set herself on. Who cares, right? Like, normally, as a Democrat, I don't care what you do. Go ahead. Light yourself on fire. But as a Harvard guy, we have to talk. We're concerned about you. Ms. Stefanik lashed out, demanding to know which of their friends had talked to him. She mocked him, saying that some of the same people, who are they? Well, the same people have told me. Well, you just said you didn't know who they are, so you didn't know who they are. Some of the same people, she said, had asked her what Mr. Moulton thought he was doing when he ran for president the previous year, although that probably did happen. He tried to get up and leave, but she pulled him back down, pressing her case. Her former friends had no idea what real Americans thought, Ms. Stefanik told him. They didn't know anything about the district she represented. But these people know you, Elise, Mr. Moulton replied, and now they feel like they don't even recognize you. Interesting. Maybe even a good point. Next up, the price of loyalty. We are getting towards the end of this one, I promise. What happened to the red wave, Congresswoman, is a quote that gets thrown here to start this next section. The day after her party's midterm underperformance, even the normally friendly hosts on Fox and Friends had questions for Ms. Stefanik. In the weeks leading to Election Day, she had predicted nothing less than a red tsunami. That's a quote. But around the country, Trump's handpicked candidates for Senate and other offices went down to defeat. Those he had endorsed in close House races ran significantly behind Republicans he had not. Hampered in part by voters' revulsion at the extreme rhetoric he had normalized in Republican circles. Fewer than a third of the female House candidates Ms. Stefanik had endorsed through her leadership PAC made it through the general election. That's a good way to screw up my metric, right? I mean, she spends hundreds of thousands of dollars on candidates, and that's why it's a quick and dirty measure. But those candidates have to win in order to be present to vote for you as a leader in the Republican Party. You got to have a good track record. So, you know, the more precise measure, I guess, would be how much money did you spend on people who made it into the conference? But that takes a lot more work than just looking at how much money got spent. Just how much money got spent is usually a good metric because people usually have a better eye for winners than Stefanik does. Anyway, Republicans will soon take control of the House, maybe, kind of. I mean, they're the majority, but they have not yet taken control of the House. With one of the slimmest margins in history, the party's House leader, Kevin McCarthy of California, has already been forced to cut deals with the most extreme members of his caucus to keep his would-be speakership alive. It's not dead quite yet. Like the party more broadly, House Republicans cannot yet afford to banish those most responsible for their quandary. But as other Republicans questioned how to wean their party off Mr. Trump, Ms. Stefanik issued her preemptive endorsement of his all-but-announced re-election campaign. In some respects, she had little choice. Ms. Stefanik is arguably more dependent on Mr. Trump's patronage than any other Republican leader. And his team soon made clear that he expects such an endorsement from anyone he was supporting for a leadership job. 2 weeks after her re-election as conference chair, when Trump dined at Mar-a-Lago with the rapper Kanye West and the young MAGA commentator Nick Fuentes, two guests with a history of anti-Semitic and racist remarks, Ms. Stefanik said nothing. Nor did she have anything to say publicly when Trump, citing stories about how Twitter had handled moderation decisions during the 2020 election, suggested termination of the Constitution might be an appropriate remedy. Harvard Institute of Politics, nothing to say about the termination, huh? Terminating the Constitution, is that what they teach you there? When Congress reconvenes, many of the younger, more Trump-critical Republicans who joined the House alongside Ms. Stefanik 8 years ago will be gone. So will all but two of the Republicans who voted to impeach him. Some in Congress believe that if Mr. McCarthy cannot corral the votes to make himself Speaker, Ms. Stefanik could offer herself up as a compromise candidate. That's why we're continuing with this like five times in a row. Just like they're going to vote for speaker 5 days in a row, 5 days in a row. I'm going to read this stupid article 5 days in a row. Yet her position may be more precarious than it appears. Unwilling to acknowledge that her politics have changed, she has never offered MAGA diehards a persuasive conversion story, leaving behind lingering suspicion. One thing I've heard consistently from pro-Trump members is that the 180 that she pulled was just so jarring, said one veteran Republican lobbyist who is in touch with a wide array of Republican lawmakers. Among her fellow Republicans, according to Republican lawmakers, Hill staff, and lobbyists, Ms. Stefanik has a reputation for being both diligent in advancing the party's message and unabashedly transactional in amassing chits of support for her own climb up the ladder. Sounds a little bit like, well, Kevin McCarthy. But then again, she's behind his candidacy. So, you know, I guess that explains it. But her campaign donations and endorsements have given her support that may be more broad than deep. For much of the spring and summer, while serving as conference chair, she quietly tested the waters for promotion to the next highest ranking House job, that of Republican whip. As the race grew more crowded, however, Ms. Stefanik found herself without a clear constituency for the position. So there's yet a little bit more to this story, and maybe making it more relevant after this. Hi, it's me, David Waldman, the same guy who was just talking to you a second ago. Our Patreon subscription drive is still going strong, with over 175 monthly donors who help keep us on the air. If we've helped keep you going during the pandemic, why not return the favor and help us keep going so we can all be together for the next disaster? Patreon.com, P-A-T-R-E-O-N.com, makes it easy to make secure, recurring monthly contributions to support our show. Patreon.com/KagroX gets you straight to our donation page. Maybe you'd like to thank us for keeping you sane during the Trump era. Maybe you're looking forward to in-depth explanations of what's going on in the Biden administration. Whatever it is that keeps you listening, we need your help to keep bringing it to you. And hey, if you happen to prefer using PayPal or even the Square Cash app, we're up and running with those options too. Thanks again, everyone, for all your support. We literally could not do this without you. All right, welcome back now to the Kagro in the Morning Show here on Netroots Radio. We'll try one more time to get through to the end of this story. We left off where? Here, where she was quietly, Stefanik is quietly testing the waters for promotion to Republican whip. But as the race grew more crowded, Stefanik found herself without a clear constituency for the position. The party's remaining moderates no longer saw her as one of them, and its right wing preferred a more consistent conservative. Only when another House member announced his interest in succeeding her as conference chair did Ms. Stefanik finally commit to running for another term in her old job. By the way, if I understand this correctly, that other colleague, other House member who expressed an interest in succeeding her was Byron Donalds. So how do you like that? I think he got about 70 votes or so for the job, but she secured it, nailed it down. And I wonder what that makes at least Stefanik think about Byron Donalds and the people who are voting for him for speaker. Not only did he lose, he lost the race to her for conference chair, but wouldn't that be interesting to see? I mean, it won't happen, but the idea that he would vault over her to become speaker because the other empty suit with no principles that she was backing, because that's the way of things and that's how I get to climb the ladder and become speaker eventually or run for president like the domain names that I've bought suggest that I want to do. And he may get in the way of that, but also I've staked my reputation on bolstering the other empty suit for a number of reasons. And he's trying to screw it up. Anyway, this is it. Finally, we get to the end of it, the last paragraph here. News stories about the upcoming presidential campaign still mention Ms. Stefanik as a rising star who might join a Trump ticket in 2024. She would vault past even Byron Donalds on that one. A political pole vault that would carry her finally to the very top of the Republican Party. But within the former president's inner circle, according to two people close to Mr. Trump, who are these people? Stories casting Ms. Stefanik as a potential running mate are regarded as clumsy plants by her own team and inspire bemusement and mockery, as though that wasn't what was going on in the press office at Trump land. Mr. Trump liked her, they said, and liked watching her defend him, but he didn't trust her. It would be hard to do it at this point, knowing what we know about her, but I'm a far less trusting person and maybe a little bit smarter even than Donald Trump, I would venture to say. So anyway, so that's it. We finally made it to the end of that. That is now all on the record, and we can refer back to that article now in its entirety, and we don't need to worry about it anymore. All right, let's see. Other things that might be wise to share as we go on. There are so many. Now we've got a big backup of these things. The thing we were reading the other day when Joan called is actually also fairly interesting, but how come I don't see it? For whatever reason, that's not as easy to find anymore. Is that this? I got to click on some things that and see if I can figure out what they are. Oh, come on, view original. Show me the original. I want to view it. You're not going to let me? All right. We were reading the other day the very interesting write-up of... dang, I don't know why this won't make itself available. But writing the write-up of why is it that members elect of the House are entitled to vote for the Speaker job before they are sworn in. And let me see if I can find this thing too, because it really was kind of a fascinating version of the story. And I'm not entirely convinced that my own political theory of why they can do this is certainly not the only one, and maybe it's not the correct one. So let's see, where do we put this thing in our list of, maybe I have to go back to my own emails to Scott with my listings of the articles that I sent him to find it. Because it's very weird the way Mastodon, things that come through from Mastodon just don't sit right with Pocket. There might be some sort of weird, I don't know what's the reason, but they don't seem to sit right. When did we do this? We did this on Wednesday, right? That was yesterday. So let's see. Is this from? I can't even. No, this is my Tuesday list. So, all right, this is a little more difficult than I thought it was going to be. It's eating up a little bit more time. I'm sorry about this, but I do think this was kind of important. Where is the here we go. From Own All the Things. Pwn All the Things, right? Matt Tate. So, let's see. We had read down to, Josh Chaffetz's quote was in here. Right. So what happens? Oh, yes. Right. I think we got to about, we have to recap on some of this stuff, right? In other words, it really is the case. We'll just pick up in the middle. For the first time in at least 100 years, the day has ended with the House having zero sitting members, right? This was his obsession, was that because they hadn't chosen a speaker, and it is the speaker who traditionally swears in members elect and makes them members, there were no members of the House. And there was that tangent about, that would obviously apply in the Senate as well. And so my old theory that now that I see John Eastman is in trouble for proposing that, hey, maybe you can just read an alternate slate of electors and that could get you landed in jail. Then maybe the idea that, hey, maybe you can just work with the 65, 66 remaining holdover senators, delay the swearing in of the new ones and conduct Senate business. Maybe that'll land me in jail at some point. Who knows? I don't know. I don't see why he should go and I shouldn't, except that I guess nobody listened to me. And that's the difference between going to jail and having a radio show. And, the difference gets smaller every day. But anyway, that's a digression. Before getting into Ben Whitty's, remember Ben Whitty's question of under what authority the representatives elect have to attend Congress and pick a speaker, it's worth pointing out an additional oddity of the House of Representatives. Unlike the Senate, which is a continuing body, the House rules also expire with each Congress. What that means is not only does the House have no members, it has no rules either. It's a sort of lawless power gap vacuum where anything would go if only there were someone with the power to do anything in it. And apparently, Chris Hayes has been spending a lot of time on his TV show. I haven't seen it, but I've seen him commenting about it on Twitter, spending a lot of time on his show talking about general parliamentary law and what is it and what does it entail and what do we do with the fact that there is not only no members of the House, but no rules for the House. Yesterday, by the way, as I mentioned, that Lauren Boebert made that incredible gaffe she meant to say it, but I don't think she meant to get the reaction that she did in attacking, who the hell was she attacking again? I can't even remember. actually attacking Kevin McCarthy, but telling him point blank that he should step down and repudiating Trump's endorsement of him, by the way, and doing it in a House floor speech, but not just any House floor speech, a House floor speech nominating a different candidate for speaker who, you know, kind of wanted to maybe be considered on his own merits for the job, and drawing boos and yada yada. There were some complaints prior to her speech. I think the nominating speech for McCarthy was delivered by a different Republican woman, Kat Comack. I can't remember what her last name actually. I think it's Comack, and she too ran into a little bit of trouble. That whole round was really kind of bad. Tempers are, I guess, patience is wearing thin, because Scott Perry, at some point later on in the day, also did a nominating speech for Byron Donalds. And likewise, his whole speech was a political attack, and he took a shot at Nancy Pelosi at some point. But Kat Comack had at some point, I think she was joking, and I think it was fairly obvious that she was joking, but it didn't go over well in a very tired and frayed House of Representatives, or House elect, anyway, whatever the hell you would describe it as, in which she said, you know, although she made comments about the fact that Democrats were probably enjoying the clown show, essentially, the fact that Republicans were unable to elect a speaker, and she made reference to, and that's why, you know, all the beach blankets and picnics and popcorn and alcohol is coming out over there on the other side. But people got upset about that. And like, hey, you're accusing us of what? Drinking during the set? We're drunk? That's why we don't want to see empty suit Kevin McCarthy be torn to shreds by the leopard face-eating party? There's plenty of reason to celebrate that without alcohol being brought into it. But people got upset about that. And you even heard people say that her words ought to be taken down. And under normal circumstances, that might be something that you could attempt to do, except the rule for taking down words is a House rule, and it's not a general parliamentary rule, and that motion would not have been in order. But it's interesting to note. Anyway, back to this article. Right. So not only does the House have no members, it has no rules. That's where the Josh Chaffetz tweet comes in, saying every year my legislation students roll their eyes when I try to explain that it matters that House rules expire and new House rules convene under a new House convenes under general parliamentary law. So what happens when the House has no rules? The answer is we look first to the Constitution itself, then to general parliamentary law as described in the applicable provisions of Jefferson's manual. I told you I've got that here at home. And I was reading it a little bit yesterday. But anyway, these rules do such ultra basic things as provide for the clerk of the House to chair the debate in the chamber until a speaker is selected. That is in Jefferson's manual. It's just not entirely clear that it's based, not entirely clear to everyone anyway, that it's based in the Constitution. I point to things in Article 1, Section 2 that say, that the clerk has this extraordinary power, as a constitutional officer. Some pushback on that Another competing theory on whether or not the clerk is a constitutional officer is, well, constitutional officers, they view very narrowly as that set of people whose positions by name are listed in the Constitution. And the clerk of the House doesn't appear anywhere in the text of the Constitution. Unless, by the way, if you really want to get super technical, the clerk of the House is mentioned forwarding the Constitution itself and the 10 Bill of Rights amendments to the state ratifying conventions. It's sent out in the name of the chair of the committee or of the convention, but also the Bill of Rights is sent out separately under the name of the Speaker of the House and the President of the Senate and the Clerk and Secretary as well. So, you know, there is a place where you could find it. But okay, never mind all of that. This person who was objecting in our discussion on Mastodon was saying that the Speaker is a constitutional officer because it says that the House shall choose its Speaker. But the House, it says, is supposed to choose its Speaker and other officers. And who are these other officers? I mean, apparently that's necessary. The Constitution says they have, you know, that there's got to be other officers, or at least it contemplates other officers. So the question is a officer of the House whose job is explicitly authorized in the Constitution, a constitutional officer, if the title of the job isn't mentioned in the Constitution? Or is it enough to say a constitutional officer is a job, is a person who's an officer of the government whose job is, you know, if not the title, the job, the work description is explicitly contemplated in the Constitution? And so anyway, it doesn't really matter whether the clerk is a constitutional officer per se. The House rules and statutory authority attaches, and the House has House and Senate together have statutorily granted the clerk of the House not only this authority, but the term of office that does not expire until a successor is named, so that the clerk's incumbency in office survives the end of one Congress and the beginning of another. So now we're here. Right. So what does the clerk get to do? Well, one of the things is preside over debate in the chamber until a speaker is elected. For debate to occur at all, and for certain motions, such as the motion to adjourn, to be passed, for the yeas and nays to be counted, all the things that the clerk is going to do, and for basically everything else to fall to ruling by the chair, which can be appealed by the full body. Anyway, you know, if you disagree with what the clerk is doing and you think she has no authority to do it, you can hold a vote to see. And if the majority of the House says something else, then the rule is something else. Anyway, it's essentially just the bare minimum to get the House into position where it can vote to select a speaker and adopt some rules and get it started on its actual work. But even a House with some basic rules needs some members, right? Which gets us back to Ben's question, under what authority do representatives elect even vote on a speaker? And there are three ways to rationalize this. Two are about defining an inherent right in the Constitution for representatives elect to vote on a speaker, and the other is a process argument about timing. Let's go through this. So two of them are about inherent rights. Okay, so the first classical argument from Deschler's precedents, which reads, although no constitutional provision uses the term members elect or representatives elect, the Constitution impliedly empowers members elect to vote for a speaker, where it says that the House shall choose a speaker before the House is sworn, and to demand the yeas and nays, and uses the term representatives when referring to members not yet sworn. Some sections of the United States Code similarly use the term members when obviously referring to members elect, and like, for instance, administration to the speaker of an oath by a member. and changing the place of meetings in Congress if necessary. As Deschler would have it, the speaker is chosen before representatives-elect take their oaths, and the Constitution requires that the House pick its own speaker. That must mean, according to Deschler, that the Constitution must imply that representatives-elect have inherent authority by raw force of election to select their speaker prior to becoming a full representative. Far be it from me, says Matt, to disagree with this approach, but I've always found this particular line of reasoning a bit dubious. And it really is, actually. After all, while it's true that the Constitution requires representatives-elect to take their oath before becoming representatives, and it's true that the House of Representatives must select their speaker, it's not all that obvious to me that the Constitution requires representatives to select their speaker before taking their oaths. By switching the order around, take the oath, then select the speaker, you avoid the whole mess. And that's true, and it would be a good idea, I think, and there's no reason why the clerk can't administer that oath necessarily. Or other members, for that matter, administering the oath to one another, or even members elect. But at the very least, I would say it does seem to be backwards. I think that the speaker should derive the power and take the oath as administered by the members. The members are creating this person speaker, and the oath should flow from them, not the other direction, I think. All right. It's true that by tradition, the speaker's oath is administered first, and the speaker then administers the oath to other members. But this is just tradition. There's no constitutional reason why the person administering the oath needs any kind of special status at all. The representatives elect could simply administer these oaths to each other. After all, the speaker in every Congress has had their oath administered to them by a representative elect. And in early House practice, representatives-elect had their oaths administered by their respective state delegations, not the speaker. So that's a good and important point. When they do finally select a speaker, the oath, as I recall, the oath is administered to the speaker by the dean of the House, who is supposed to be the longest serving member of the House. And I can never remember this whenever we go over this. Is it the longest serving member of the majority party or just the longest serving member? And you would think that for this purpose, it shouldn't matter. But, you know, that's one of those things. Maybe it only matters when things aren't going smoothly. Like, what if the dean of the House is a Democrat or the longest serving member of the House is a Democrat? And that may actually be true. And they elect the speaker, and it's somebody as uniquely unqualified as Kevin McCarthy or worse. What happens if the dean of the House says, I'm not going to do it? Well, I mean, it doesn't really matter, I don't think, because they could just get the senior most Republican to do it. Neither one of them are members of the House at the moment. They haven't been sworn in yet. But under normal procedure, a member elect, the dean of the House, swears in the speaker, and that's only by tradition. I think they're right. It really could be anybody. There's certainly nothing in the Constitution that says the dean of the House has to do it. It's merely tradition. And I guess if they're all just members elect, there's probably a stronger claim for the clerk of the House to administer the oath. And I think I sometimes get confused and think that that is the case because that makes more sense. It's just a weird thing. Very strange political theory nit to pick at here. All right. So yes, a better way, he then goes on to say, to get to the same argument, at least in my view, is to use Article 1, Section 5, Clause 1, which says, each house shall be the judge of the elections, returns, and qualifications of its own members, and a majority of each shall constitute a quorum to do business. But a small, you know, goes on, the stuff that doesn't really matter as much for these purposes is a smaller number may adjourn from day to day, be authorized to compel attendance, da-da-da-da-da. The real key part, they're the judge of their own elections. That's why they can reject people's election certificates. That's why they can... Well, this isn't why they can expel members, but this is why I don't think we've gotten to the final word on the power of members of Congress to refuse to seat people. I think the Adam Clayton Powell case confused things a little bit. But I don't think we've heard the final word on that. And the George Santos story is the kind of story which, under slightly different circumstances, might finally let us clarify that. Anyway, here, this argument relies on the House being the judge of the returns of its own members. For the Senate, this poses no problem. The sitting senators can judge the returns of senators-elect with no issue. But for the House, this leads to a catch-22 situation. How can anyone judge the validity of an incoming representative's election if there are no representatives yet to judge it? And if all of them are elected without judging, then what's the point of the clause? You can't even do it iteratively, because then the first person to take the oath has nobody able to judge it, and the Constitution expressly strips anyone other than the House from making the judgment. Here's where I think that's where the clerk comes in. The clerk, after all, their chief job at this stage of the game is to receive all the certificates of election and determine that they're all regular and correct in form, and that these are the people who are supposed to be here as members elect. I think if you extend that power just a little further and say, and by virtue of that, the clerk is fairly certain that the people who are casting these ballots for Speaker of the House prematurely are the people who are, in fact, entitled to be there as members once all of the ministerial stuff gets out of the way, then fine. You chose to do it this way. You chose to have the speaker take the oath first and then administer to the rest of you. All right. But I'm the one who checked everybody's certificates. I'm the one who should be, A, swearing in the speaker, and B, admitting people to the hall of the House and saying that these people are entitled to a vote and others are not. That's inherent in the job. And then the speaker from that point on can swear people in, and then I guess they are the judges of their own elections. And I guess it's a little bit less of a contradiction in terms if you are explicitly saying outright, I know it's weird and self-referential, but the House is the judge of its own elections. So, you know, there's going to be a reflexive property to this at some point or another. And that's just the way it is. How is it constitutional? I don't know. It just says it in the Constitution. So therefore, it's constitutional, even if it doesn't make any sense. All right, a little bit more on this. It therefore makes sense to conclude that the House doing the judging of returns in Article 1, Section 5 must be a House made up of representatives elect and not representatives. By extension, if the Constitution envisages that representatives elect are the House in Article 1, Section 5 for purposes of returns, then perhaps they are also the House in Article 1, Section 2 for the purpose of choosing a speaker. At least to me, this seems like a stronger form of Deschler's argument, though I am certainly no Deschler. Even here, you could perhaps argue that the Constitution could be read, despite common practice, to allow the previous Congress to judge the returns of the incoming Congress prior to leaving office, to avoid the implication. I think putting it on the clerk helps avoid that complication. There's a bunch of reasons why I think that's an even more problematic argument than it falling to the incoming group of representatives. But I include it for the sake of argument because it means even here the implied right of representatives elect to pick a speaker prior to their taking the oath of office isn't automatic. There are other ways to read the clause. But to me, the strongest alternative take is that the representatives elect's choice to pick a speaker is really an informal vote, this is interesting, that is formalized with the adoption of House rules once everyone's oaths are taken, thus avoiding the temporal gap. In other words, the order of operations is, one, representatives choose who their speaker will be, representatives elect, really, and this process gets the pomp that implies but does not actually entail a binding vote. The winner, then, number two, of the informal vote takes their oath. The other members, then, are sworn in by that first member and themselves, therefore, become full members. And then finally, members then vote on the rules, which are adopted, and this formalizes the selection of the speaker and the rules, by the way. So inherent in adopting the rules, one of the rules is the House will get together and choose its speaker and members elect will cast their ballots. And now that they're members, they ratify that procedure after the fact. That's an interesting construct. Which one of these three arguments you prefer, he says, is up to you. It doesn't really matter because in real life, and this is what we were talking about with Greg and sort of the understandings and the tacit agreements, et cetera, right? In real life, the power of representatives elect to pick a speaker comes from the more arcane and normative feature of the power gap itself. They are representatives by force of election, and no technicality of ordering in the pomp of the transfer will deny it to them, since the order of events at the start of the Congress are, in reality, mostly ceremonial. Luckily for the representatives elect, there's not a lot of practical difference between being a representative elect and a representative until the speaker is selected anyway. Representatives elect mostly obtain the same powers and privileges of their full counterparts, including some of the protections of the speech and debate clause, compensation, office spaces, and expenses. All right, I'm way behind on getting the music started here. It's true that they cannot vote on or introduce legislation, and that's true, and that's something that is currently being noticed by writers over at the New York Times, according to an article sent to me by my brother Mark. Thanks very much for checking in with that one. It's true, they cannot vote to introduce legislation, but until there's a speaker, they can't do that anyway. In fact, the only obvious difference is that the payment of their salaries might be delayed if the situation is not resolved prior to the end of the month. So, if it's resolved in less than a month, they won't even notice the difference. And let's be real, if it takes more than a month, they've got much bigger problems to deal with anyway. So what do you think of that? We made it to the end, finally, but artificially delaying the end of the program, of course. Apologies to Justice Putnam, the rest of you waiting for the West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy will find that it comes up very easily next, right here on Netroots Radio. Why don't we use this delay to preview things for you? Guess what? There'll be no live broadcast of the show until January 16th, when the new MacBook is ready and online. Oh, who even knew? Oh, I'm sorry to hear about that. I missed that warning from the other day. Podcasts, though, of course, available on Spreaker and wherever your podcasts can be found. All right, that's too bad. We'll go podcast on this for the
from
time being.
Radio.com. You have been listening to Kagro in the Morning with Waldman.
Well, here's what he's got on tap for you, podcast-wise anyway. Elon Musk is the king of trolls, mostly because the media keeps feeding the troll. On the rest of the menu, the Justice Department has settled with a Mexican man who was arrested in the early days of the Trump administration despite his DACA status. Let's figure out how that happened and how it gets sorted out next.